panel of this conference, which we titled The Ubiquitous Security Question, because of course you can't get away from it. The moderator for this panel will be Professor Hassan Abbas, who was with us at Columbia for a year and then left us to take up a job at the National Defense University, where he is, from what I understand, solely responsible for educating army officers, defense service people, defense analysts, and so we're very grateful that at least there's a good teacher. Professor Abbas is full professor at the National Defense University. For those of you in your packets who read about him as an assistant professor, that was our mistake. I'm sorry, he's a full professor. We meant him no disrespect. And I'll turn the floor over to Professor Abbas.
Thank you very much, Anaki. As far as I'm concerned, I'm just a humble student of history and politics and culture of South Asia. Thank you very much, Anaki and Bill and Aparna for organizing this this conference. Of course, the security question. As much as we would like, we cannot run away from it. In terms of my personal opinion, my views are more with what Asim's had said, but he might see this as a contradiction that a person who's a security analyst and claiming to be an expert on security issues is agreeing with him. However, we have a great panel, a very able, very scholarly, very well established in their own fields. And just a two-liner thing, the general questions that we will look at, or we requested all the scholars to cover in their presentations, in addition to the other issues that they think are relevant, were primarily that how central really is the security question? How is it related to economic issues, whether there is any regional context or regional solutions which are there, and last but not the least, whether the kind of radicalization trends which are at the core of the security issue in Pakistan and Bangladesh, whether they are related to religion in any way or not. These are the general questions. I will briefly introduce all the speakers before they start, but I'll begin with our first speaker, Naeem Mohaiemen, who will basically talk about Chittagong Hills and the security issues related to that within Bangladesh. He's a writer, he's an independent scholar, a filmmaker, and an artist based in Dhaka, and also he lives part of the time in New York. Most of his activism, if I may call that, is also linked to religious and ethnic minorities in Bangladesh, but specifically to Chittagong Hills. I welcome him to start his presentation.
Thank you for that introduction. Just get started here.
And I forgot to mention about your most recent publication, which is also on this issue.
Just slides. So
you want us to move right in?
Sure. And would be great to have the lights off, just because these are black and white photographs. So anyway, a little hard to see. Well, thank you for the introduction, and thank you to the conference organizers, especially Janaki, Dina, Mr. Akbar, Bill, Annapurna, and everybody else who worked to make this happen. Thank you for inviting all of us, including those of us who are in slightly unconventional spaces within and outside academia. Today, as mentioned, I will talk about the Chittagong Hill tracks in Bangladesh and the way in which a security discourse assists a slow motion process of ethnic displacement, racist but also commercially opportunist in nature. I will also explore the parallels with Bangladesh's own experience with the Pakistan state until 1971 and how that has affected activism around this issue. It's a good day to be speaking at Columbia University again. Sorry, don't know why that's doing that. The last time I spoke here was possibly when the oral history department asked me to present a video project about 1971, about the 1971 war. The title of the slide comes from a book we published last year called Between Ashes and Hope, Chittagong Hill Tracks in the Blind Spot of Bangladesh Nationalism. And I'll talk also about the grammatically incorrect formulation of Bangladesh nationalism. Since we are at Columbia, I will diverge for a moment from my presentation to express briefly the disappointment that I and many other Bangladeshi colleagues felt when we learned that Columbia University Press had published Sharmila Bose's Dead Reckoning, a book that actively attempts to erase all charges of genocide and rape by the Pakistan Army and their Bengali collaborators during the 1971 war. Of course, as Sara Hussein reinforced earlier before this session in a conversation we're having, we all respect free speech, but it is worth questioning how an academic pedigree and a resulting perception of added legitimacy is granted only to certain projects. While the book's initial publisher in UK is Hearst & Company, and in India it was Hachette, one would expect Columbia University to require an academic peer review prior to republication of this book. Either that process was bypassed, or I would say perhaps done in a cursory fashion. Because about this book, among many other critics, Srinath Raghavan wrote, "It is impossible to review the entire catalog of evasions, obfuscations, omissions, and methodological errors that suffuse the book. Nevertheless, it has been published by Columbia, and perhaps buoyed by this university's academic seal of approval, Bose has secured a fourth publisher, Oxford University Press in Pakistan." The appearance of this book at a time when the Bangladesh government is in the middle of international war crimes tribunals related to 1971, and the fact that Bose is speaking at Harvard, Oxford, and elsewhere discussing this same war crimes tribunal, suggests that the academic platform can be transformed into a soapbox to actively bias the war crimes trial process in Bangladesh. We should pause to consider that Bose's book, which is in my mind a work of genocide denial, would not be so smoothly acceptable were it some of the other horrendous genocides of the 20th century, the Holocaust, Rwanda, Yugoslavia, or Cambodia. The fact that the 1971 genocide can be erased so completely and earn the author academic kudos gives an indication of how much work remains to establish even the basic contours of 1971. Therefore, before turning to the case of the Chittagong Hill Tracks, I will draw your attention to this URL where you can download my rebuttal of Dead Reckoning, which was published last month in Economic and Political Weekly, where I catalog the book's record of bias and methodological error. I'll be happy to discuss this further on another occasion. Now, I'll come to the crisis in the Chittagong Hill Tracks, or CHT. These are the three mountain districts in the southeast of Bangladesh, which are geographically distinct and home to Bangladesh's most significant indigenous people's population. These are 13 ethnic groups, sometimes incorrectly lumped together as Chakma, but actually collectively called the Pahari, or by their own more politically assertive term, the Jumma people. This is the site of a low-level guerrilla war for regional autonomy since the mid-1970s. After the 1997 peace accord, the guerrilla war officially ended, but the militarization continued, along with a long process of ethnic displacement via the Bengali settler program. This process, which started with government support and funding, has now rendered the formerly 93% majority Jumma people into a less than 50% minority in their own regional homeland. I should mention that the images you'll see are the chapter divisions for each of the sections of the book. I want to look briefly at two aspects: the manner in which Chittagong Hill Tracks represents a blind spot and exclusion from the idea of Bangladesh, and the manner in which security and territorial integrity is used as a rationale to continue keeping the region as a militarized zone, subject to settler policy to alter the demographics. In this book we published last year, we deliberately used the grammatically incorrect term Bangladesh nationalism, meant to indict both the Bengali nationalism, which perhaps was an Awami League project after 1971, as well as a direct result of the war, and the Bangladeshi nationalism project articulated from 1975 onward by General Ziaur Rahman. Of course, the problems of the CHT predate 1971, especially the 1960s building of the Kaptai hydroelectric dam, which, like many such large donor-funded Great Leap Forward projects, started by displacing large portions of the homes of indigenous people, leading to thousands of them seeking refuge in India. However, while the 1960s was marked by collateral damage from development projects, the 1970s marked a shift as a new country came into being. As part of the process of solidifying the separation from Pakistan and clarifying the ideological basis for the new country, the new Bangladesh constitution inserted the definition of the people of Bangladesh as Bengali. And that's, of course, the Shahid Minar, site of many symbolic acts of Bengali nationalism, but here surrounded by Jumma people protesting one of the recent massacres in Chittagong Hill Tracks. while the justification at that time was partially the exclusion of the country's remaining Urdu-speaking population after 71, a far bigger exclusion was the Jumma population. The Bangladesh Constitution's architect, Dr. Kamal Hussain, recently remarked in a Dhaka seminar that the exclusion of the indigenous people was a historic mistake. But in 1972, the only voice that spoke out against this in parliament was of the sole indigenous people's MP elected from the CHT, Manobendra Narayan Larma, who protested on the parliament floor during the debate on the constitution, under no definition or logic can a chakma be a Bengali or a Bengali be a chakma. As citizens of Bangladesh, we're all Bangladeshis, but we also have a separate ethnic identity, which unfortunately the Awami League leaders do not want to understand. In that hypercharged moment, when Urdu speakers in the new country were under fire, the Constitution Committee finally refused to include any reference to indigenous people or any other non-Bengali people in the Constitution. Now, if we look at my fellow panelist Saadia Toor's new book on Pakistan, State of Islam, we see that in the 1950s, the early dissenters against the idea of a hegemonic Muslim Urdu-first Pakistani state were often Bengali Hindu members of the assembly in East Pakistan who would become double minorities in this new structure. Similarly, in the 1970s, some of the loudest dissent against the new structures being set up for Bangladesh came from the ethnic Jumma minority community, especially Manobendra Narayan Larma, who was a continuous dissident voice up to 1975. Unfortunately, the Bangladesh state's response was also equally willfully patronizing and chauvinistic. Manobendra Larma, who is now called the founding father of the Jumma people, was on a collision course with Sheikh Mujib, who considered himself the national father after 1971. This was cemented when Sheikh Mujib reportedly said in February 1973, "From today, there are no tribal subgroups in Bangladesh. Everyone is a Bengali." After the 1975 assassination of Sheikh Mujib, political earthquakes began, and while the nation was focused on the battle for supremacy between various factions of the Bengali Muslim elite within the civilian and military forces, Larma went into hiding and the Shanti Bahini was formed as an armed guerrilla army fighting for an independent land or regional autonomy, at least in the Chittagong Hill Tracks. Now, while the 1972 to 75 period was marked by neglect and marginalization, the post-1975 era saw the military regime of General Zia engage in direct military confrontation with the Shanti Bahini, leading to complete militarization and a 1:5 ratio between local people and soldiers. Even more lethal is the beginning of the government-funded settler program, where poor landless Bengali settlers were brought in from the flood-prone plainlands to occupy land belonging to Jumma people. One can see here a slight parallel with the migration of Urdu speakers to parts of East Pakistan after 1947, although the details diverge once you dig deeper. General Zia's particular innovation was to move the Bengali settlers into cluster villages where they serve as strategic hamlets, which always needed military protection from the possibility of attacks by the Shanti Bahini. The military's attitude toward the Jumma people can be seen in the 1977 local meeting where Chittagong Cantonment Area Commander Major General Munzur announced, "We don't want you. You can go off wherever you please. We just want your land." The same Munzur later led the military coup that assassinated Zia in 1981. When escaping from the manhunt, he and his rebels took refuge in the mountains and were allegedly, according to newspapers, finally discovered hiding in a Jumma family home. These are the many ironies of this particular history. Just as in 1971, India is a player in this period, especially post-75, as the Shanti Bahini locates some of its training camps across the border. It is therefore also partially the Indian state's withdrawal of support in the 1990s that eventually leads to the signing of the 97 peace accord. While the Shanti Bahini demobilizes after this accord, for the last 14 years, no Bangladesh government has fulfilled their part of the agreement. The region remains highly militarized, with the largest presence of military camps and cantonments out of any district of Bangladesh. In addition, the last two Bangladesh civilian governments have started a new campaign where they have stated at international forums, Bangladesh has no indigenous people, which has been repeated by the last two foreign ministers of civilian governments. Now, let's pause for a second to consider how the parallels with 1971 have been helpful, not just to frame this conflict as a continuation of a pattern of former minoritarian communities absorbing and refining the patterns of their own experience on newer minorities, but also as an activist tool. Because while the mainstream of Bangladeshi opinion is not yet able to fully absorb the idea that Bengali, and particularly Bengali Muslim nationalism, excludes many others, it is possible to appeal to sentiment when activists invoke the idea. This is what Pakistan also did in 1971, quote unquote. Thus, Saadia Gulrukh writes in the book, "Since 1971, we have been absorbed in building a nation state exclusively for Bengalis. Our circle of grief reflects that. It excludes all others.
We are unable to inhale the fragrance of any flowers but Shapla Shaluk or Kathal Chapa. Now, turning to the security question, there are two ways that the CHT issue is kept alive even after 1997 peace accord. First is a continued media argument that the Jummah people want to carve out a separate country, even though all factions of the Jummah movement now clearly state, in a time of reduced expectations, that they want to have regional self-rule and representation. The second is the argument that neighboring India has territorial interest in the region, as well as the various agencies, multinationals, etc., that have started working in the area. In his essay, Blood-Soaked CHT and the Vendor Odometer, Pavel Partho writes, Chakma, Marma, Bom, Tripura, Lushai, Pankho, Khumi, Mro, Chak, Tongchanga, Mijo, Kuki, Asham, Nepali, Shautal, Maitai, Monipuri, Khyang. Many names, one bracket. This bracket indiscriminately, but evenly, slathers a fistful of ignorant generalizations to all within. Flat nose, jungle braving, snakes, frogs, and everything in between eating, Changbang speaking, forestry destroying, Jum cultivating, occult worshipping, simple, terrifying, primitive, and occasionally naked people. Oh, and of course, they keep wanting to separate the hill tracks from the rest of Bangladesh. So innocent Bangladeshis sacrifice their own lives to keep them in order. End quote. I want to also refer to anthropologist Rehnuma Ahmed and her essay, The Bengali Sense of Victimhood, which dissects at length this cartoon, where the sleeves on the left say European Commission, Chittagong Hill Tracks Commission, and Christian Missionary. The sleeves on the right say UPDF and JSS, which are the two main Jumma political groups. And she says, the arms on the left side of the map are clothed civil. The arms on the right are bare, uncovered, barbaric. A nation besieged by enemies within and without. The cartoon evokes a sense of crisis, fear, anxiety. It is, I thought to myself, a perfect example of all that which bedevils the nation nearly 40 years after independence. Those present and named are the enemies. These foes are both internal and external. They are out to destroy the nation, to sever its limbs. I cannot help but think, how would the cartoonist have portrayed 1971? East Pakistan being cut asunder? By who? Aided by who? But of course, let me add, when I compare the situation in the CHT at present to the situation confronting Pakistan in 1971, I do not do so, this is still Rehnuma speaking, from an ulterior motive of advocating a breakup or secession or any such thing. I do it because Ekattur has taught me, Ekattur meaning 71, that to survive as a nation, one must not only be able to accommodate cultural differences, but to welcome them. That where the centers of power label a conspiracy is most likely a political problem, one that must be resolved politically, never ever through the deployment of brute force. And then she adds, genuine attempts must be made to undo historical wrongs before it is too late. End quote. Now, I identify myself and many of our colleagues who worked on this book as being of the Bangladesh left, a force that has been at the front line of the CHT issue for many years, going back to the 1980s, when left leaders such as Anu Mohammed and Rehnuma Ahmed and many others took the first vocal role speaking out on Chittagong Hill Tracks. And one thing we noticed when we did the book, because the book attempted to be half Jumma writers, half Bengali writers, in general, Bengali writers were able to be much more critical of the military and the state for obvious reasons, which is that they had much less fear. And when Jumma writers were asked where were their more radical critiques, they generally said that's not something we dare publish, given what the retaliation can be. So when our book was published last year, some of us were asked why this had been our singular focus for the last decade. Why hill tracks, someone asked. Deshe to onek shomoshya. Country has many problems. For all of us within the Bangladesh left, Chittagong Hill Tracks is the blind spot at the heart of Bengali and Bangladeshi nationalism. The bloody history of the hills expresses a continuing contradiction between our history of liberation from Pakistan, Ekattur, and our replication of that same hegemony, language, security, regional autonomy on our Jumma citizens. The continued media agitprop about insurgents, miscreants, foreign interference, and who is indigenous tries to drown out our reality with a wall of white noise. Confounding the contours of the conflict is the state strategy of using landless subaltern Bengali peasants as a weapon of ethnic displacement, a project that grants state actors the convenient shield of both sides are landless, even though only one side is backed by state funding, institutions, and firepower. But to be sure, the presence of landless peasants as the occupying force presents a major problem also for the left. Fabrications regarding the Jumma people's struggle are so insidious, they reveal the infrastructure and profit potential of Bengali racism. For some time now, we have been discussing the need to publish counter-narratives, Jumma voices, Bengali refuseniks, and conscientious objectors. This book was one among many such efforts. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker, next panelist is Shuja Nawaz, who is currently at the South Asia Center at the Atlantic Council in Washington, D.C. He has been in media. He has started his career from Pakistan Radio and Pakistan Television, then wrote for New York Times, various other publications. Most recently, he is known for his book on Pakistan Army, Crossed Swords, Pakistan, Its Army and the Wars Within. And he's one of those few South Asians and Pakistanis in Washington, D.C., who are making a significant contribution to the policy discussions and debates. Welcome, Shuja.
Thank you very much, Hassan, and thank you to the organizers, Janaki and Annapurna and Bill and Akbar, for inviting me. In the interest of truth in advertising, I must let you know I'm not a scholar. Or an academic. I have no pretensions to being one. I'm simply trying to act as a translator in Washington of what I hear and read and try and understand about my region, which is South Asia, encompassing not just geographic South Asia, but also the Gulf states, Iran, Afghanistan, and Central Asia as a single entity, and helping people in Europe and North America understand what the region is all about, and creating a forum. It's a delight to be back at Columbia, which takes me back to being a student. 40 years ago, I was here as a grad student. And each time I come back, I learn something. And from yesterday's excellent sessions, I think I learned much more than I thought I ever would. My mind is still reeling from it. Let me begin by saying that the question of security is not simply external security. It is both external and internal, and they are interlinked. And to my mind, internal security trumps everything. And this is a realization that, particularly in Pakistan, people are increasingly coming to. Or if they aren't, they ought to. Because if they do not control the internal security situation and change the conditions that result from the lack of security, then all the efforts at trying to control or prepare for external security will be for naught. And by internal security, I really mean a very wide range of security conditions, including that of the human being, the right to speak, the right to pursue what you want to do, what religious approach you have, what political approach you have, as well as the resolution of differences between the center and the periphery, which have dogged Pakistan from its birth in 1947. The other is that the external security does have a very powerful influence on what happens internally. And given the interest of time, I'm just going to spend very quick bullet points on these and hope that the discussion will then emerge in our question and answer. But I cite the example of Turkey and Greece. Once the Turks realized that there was really no need to be hostile towards Greece, the deployment of an armored div and supporting forces in the European side of the Bosphorus was really not necessary. Once the Soviet Union collapsed, as a natural corollary, the role of the military started becoming less. And the space for the civilians who were now ready, willing, and able to occupy that space, and who were ready, willing, and able to prepare themselves to occupy that space. And that is the difference, I think, that lies between them and Pakistan today, that we can learn from. And so if Pakistan manages to find a way of ending a situation that one of the more thoughtful generals that I've talked to in Pakistan calls no war, no peace, and makes it a situation of normalcy with its neighbors, then it is quite possible in the not too distant future that there will not be a need for the military to be such a dominating force in Pakistan's polity. Another general point to begin with is that Pakistan inherited from the British and solidified for itself a position as a security state. From the get-go, it was the military that tried to bypass the political decision makers. In fact, even bypass their own military superiors through the actions of a group of adventurous officers, which I've covered in some extensive detail based on my work on the archives that I discovered at Army headquarters in Rawalpindi. And so this has been the bane of Pakistan's existence, and Pakistan continues to pay the price for this security state that emerged in the wake of the collapse of the British Empire and the partition of Pakistan. I was also struck at the demonstration effect or contagion effect, call it what you will, of Pakistan on Bangladesh. Even with Naeem's, when he was making his presentation, that today the Bangladesh military or the government uses some of the same very peculiar archaic English words like miscreant to describe people. As a journalist covering the 1971 conflict and working for Pakistan Television since 69, I never understood what this word meant, because in old English it had a very proper, precise meaning. It was somebody that deviated from the religious path. And I don't think that the Pakistan Army understood that that's what they were talking about. And to this day, they continue to use this word to describe people that they don't agree with, whether it's in Balochistan or in the Northwest Frontier Province or Khyber Pakhtunkhwa or in Fatah. And so I find it amusing and very ironic that our Bangladeshi brothers and sisters in positions of authority are employing the same language that was once used against them by the Pakistan military. Now, a last general point, and which is that the Pakistani state has inherited many of the characteristics of preceding empires in South Asia. This is a very broad and bold statement, and I'm sure historians in this room are going to take me apart. But you know, I go back to sources like Bailey and David Washbrook, and I cite the fiscal military state that was the British Empire, and that is in many ways being continued in Pakistan, and has been continued to some extent at different stages in the life of independent Bangladesh, where the military chooses to use the state as a source of economic sustenance and continuity for itself to remain in power. So I'm just sort of, this is the backdrop against which I will talk about five different points as briefly as I can and to stay within the limits. One is the continuing clash between the civil and the military in Pakistan. Secondly, the rising economic crises inside Pakistan that is affecting how the military views itself and its role. Thirdly, how the internal security is gradually becoming a greater danger than external security threats. Fourth, the state of political checkmate inside Pakistan, and how the end game in Afghanistan is likely to affect that situation. And fifth, to end on a more positive note, to respond to one of our moderators' questions, what are the regional options, and do they offer any hope? So first of all, there has been and continues to be a clash between the civil and the military. They run on parallel tracks. The civilian democratic government has very carefully, in my mind, chosen to cede ground to the army and has outsourced the war on militancy and terror inside the borders of Pakistan. This was in addition to what has been outsourced by previous governments, including that of military autocrats, where the hardcore military at army headquarters basically called the shots on Kashmir, on the Afghan policy, on nuclear issues, and then increasingly on US-Pakistan relations. And as I will say later, now increasingly on economic matters. So when you outsource such a large proportion of your governmental remit, then what sort of governance is left for you to exercise? you're basically ceding the ground and losing your legitimacy, which the ballot box provided you. So that is my complaint about civilian rulers. But I can understand that when you have a political system which is dominated by political parties that are run as family businesses, that all they're interested in is protecting their narrow interests, as Asim was saying, increasingly tighter circles which they're willing to protect because they all have an out. They have Canadian passports and they have contracts with Dubai firms to evacuate families at 2 hours' notice by air. So the trouble is that the majority of the 185 million people of Pakistan do not have that option. And so it's a disservice to the people that elected government when government chooses to be so callous and cynical in the way it cedes ground on governance. Very interesting, in my book I talked about it, and it took me some time to actually track the evolution of changes in the old imperial warrant of precedence, which was the rank order of people in government, including civil and military, where after partition, Pakistan regularly, and even under periods of civilian rule, promoted the military to a higher rank in the warrant of precedence. And Bangladesh obviously inherited that system, but I think at the government of Khalida Zia actually reverted back to the warrant of precedent at the time of 1947. Pakistan, of course, has been going the other way. I remember mentioning this to Prime Minister Sharif, and who said, oh yes, now I see what happened. Because he didn't know about this, although he had promoted the military to higher ranks vis-a-vis their civilian counterparts. That when he arrived in Dhaka, and he was looking for the army chief at the head of the line, or at number two or number three, and he said he finally saw him at the end of the reception line, where he properly belonged. So in Pakistan, it was the other way around. In Bangladesh, I think you did the right thing, and Pakistan has to learn from Bangladesh on that as well as others. The second issue is the economic issue, and now the military is playing a much faster and more active role in economic issues for two reasons. One, it owns a lot of the economy through its commercial as well as its defense industries. Through a policy of import substitution, it is producing, for reasons of autarky, misplaced in my view, those goods inside Pakistan which it could easily import for military production and defense at a much cheaper rate from outside. I've cited one example of a washer for the G3 rifle that is produced at 25 rupees a washer. Internally, could be imported from Malaysia at 5 rupees a washer. Secondly, as the economic pie shrinks, so does the military's share. And so it runs into a problem that the only way it can acquire additional resources is by forcing the government to resort to deficit financing, which creates inflation, creates unrest, and reduces the value of the money that it has. So this is really now forcing it to rethink its approach. And we don't know which way it's going to come out, but these are trends to watch. Thirdly, I think increasingly a debate within the military is occurring. It may not be a very loud debate and may not be very evident to people on the outside, but the fact that people are thinking about it is important for the first time, that it's the wars within which are more important than the potential wars outside. And they keep talking of capacity and capability versus the intentions for external actors like India. They also don't know the capacity and the capability of the internal actors inside Pakistan, because they are now formed into syndicates which the military, in their heart of hearts, should know that they cannot take on. Whether it's the alliance between the Punjabi militants and the TTP and the Afghan Taliban or Al-Qaeda, there is no way that an army of 500,000 can take on these forces and fight urban guerrilla warfare and fight against suicide bombers and succeed. you really have to change the landscape, and the military never knows how to change that landscape. It's not equipped to do that. That can only be done by a civilian entity and by the people of Pakistan deciding what they want to do. Very interesting quote from 2009 when Lieutenant General Ahmed Shuja Pasha was made the head of the ISI. He speaks German fluently, so he gave an interview to Der Spiegel in German, in which, and I quote him, this is almost verbatim, because it's kind of ingrained in my tiny memory banks. He said, "We are not completely mad. We know that the threat is internal. It is not India." Now, if that is, if he's not blowing smoke, if we take him at face value, then I think there is some hope that there would be a concentration of effort on changing the internal landscape. And that's something to look out for. These are, again, trends. I won't predict the future, but that's what I would be looking out for. The fourth issue, I said, was political checkmate. Pakistan today is in a situation where, for the first time in its history, the military does not have a political party waiting in the wings, that it is preparing to take over. It doesn't have that option any longer. It has the People's Party. It thinks it has the People's Party where it belongs, and I would hope, expect that the People's Party thinks it has where the military where it belongs. Because once the People's Party succeeds in securing the Senate next year, it would make eminent sense to call a snap general election and put itself in an overwhelmingly powerful position where it can even take on the military and do a Nawaz Sharif on them. And so the next 2 years are going to be important to see how this goes. The demographic trends that we talked about before this morning session and that were talked about by Asim also will affect this, because with an increasingly urban population, if and when the census is completed, it's bound to have an effect on the political landscape of Pakistan, shifting the balance in favor of the cities. And the cities will become important, and Karachi is going to be a litmus test for Pakistan, because it's a perfect cross-section of Pakistani society. It's the largest Pakhtun city in the world, 4 to 5 million people, population of 18 million and growing. And you can't throw the Pakhtun out, neither can you throw the Mahajir out, neither can you throw the Sindhi out, nor can you throw the Punjabi immigrant out. So they all will have to learn to live together. So against this political checkmate, I think the role and the ability of the military to use its coercive power, or the threat of coercive power, to my mind, is much more reduced than at any time in history. And so although General Kiani may want to take credit for saying he wants to keep the military out of politics, and he's only playing a scene, a role behind the scenes, and we can give him credit for that, and I'm sure Ehtezaz will talk about that to some extent today in reference to the Long March and the Army's intervention in that. There is also a question of necessity, because what can they do and how will they do it? There can't be another coup. It means basically Pakistan taking a kind of poison pill defense against the rest of the world. And now the Afghan endgame is going to increase these pressures, because the United States is getting desperate. It is facing a situation which Robert Baer, a former station chief in Riaz, who was on a radio program with me recently, was saying that the departure from the top of the embassy in Saigon will look like a cakewalk. If that's the case, the pressures will mount and are mounting. I deal with people on the Hill. They're loaded for bear as far as Pakistan is concerned. They're going to put increasing pressure on Pakistan, but again, my own reading of history, of the relationships between these two frenemies, is that when the US increases the pressure, the Pakistanis react in an extremely negative and perverse manner, which the US doesn't understand and cannot understand. And so it's kind of a political military chicken. And even the overwhelming superiority of the military and their ability to pinpoint and bomb targets inside Pakistan is not going to be enough because they cannot occupy Pakistan. They couldn't occupy Afghanistan. They couldn't occupy Iraq. And so 185 million people with trained military manpower of 800,000, maybe up to a million, with including the paramilitary forces, is going to be a pretty hefty challenge for any superpower. And I don't think this administration really has it in it to undertake any military adventure outside the borders, particularly given 2012, which is looming on the political horizon. Now, let me end on a more optimistic note. And I say this because I'm often accused in Washington of being an optimist, and then I'm reminded, and Mooed has heard this before, by my friend Arno de Burgrave, that a pessimist is an optimist with experience. So that kind of brings me back to reality. But I believe that in the end, it is changing the people-to-people relationships and the trade relationships in the region that offers the fastest, best way of changing a hostile situation to a less than hostile situation, and then perhaps into a peaceful situation. And at my center in Washington, we've presented a number of studies, and I'll just throw out a few data points that I've repeated elsewhere. According to one report, one study that Mohsen Khan did and presented at our center, if you go back to the proportion of trade between the areas that are now Pakistan and India, at the time of partition, when 70% of their trade was with each other, using the gravity model, where trade flows from the larger entity to the smaller entity, you will increase what is currently a $2 billion a year trade through official channels to as much as $100 billion a year trade. And another calculation by Shahid Javed Berkey indicates that this will have an income effect of increasing per capita GDP in Pakistan by $875, and in India, with its much larger population, by over $1,200. If this happens, it transforms the economic and, dare I say, political landscape of the Punjab. It transforms central and southern Punjab, which is also the area where the military recruits the most now, no longer the northern tier districts of northern Punjab. And southern and central Punjab is also the area where the militancy recruits the most. So if you drain that swamp and create the economic interests and opportunities, then the possibility of peace breaking out in the subcontinent increases greatly. Not only that, but when you extend the Afghan-Pakistan Transit Trade Agreement to India, you open India's relationships with Afghanistan and Central Asia. You open the possibility of cheap energy, which India will need every ounce in order to compete on the global and regional scale with China and everybody else. Not only to TAPI, the Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India pipeline, but also to the import of cheap hydroelectricity from Tajikistan, as well as from the Kabul Gorge project in Afghanistan. And then, once the border ceases to be a point of contention, you also have the possibility of joint ownership of hydroelectricity projects on the Indus water basin between India and Pakistan. This may be a pipe dream, but I believe I'm waging peace, and I think this is all possible. I'll end on a quote from not one, but any number of directors general of the ISI. When I was working on my book, I asked them all the same question. What would be the effect on Pakistan's security of opening the border with Pakistan, with India? What if you could get a visa on arrival, or if there were no visa at all? What would be the security effect? And to a man, including the former head of the ISI, who's now head of the Pakistan Army, they all said the same one word: nothing. And so I asked them why, and they said, because the guys that cross the border to do things that we don't want them to do are not applying for a visa. They can come at will. If that's the reality, I think it's about time we realized it and understood it and acted upon it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shuja. Next panelist is Ali Riaz. He's a professor and chair of the Department of Politics and Government at Illinois State University. He was educated in Dhaka as well as in Hawaii. He has written extensively on the issues of security and religious extremism in Bangladesh. His most recent book is Political Islam and Governance in Bangladesh.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Abbas, for generous introduction, and thank you to Dina and Janaki for the invitation here. It's really good to be at Columbia. As you know, we have been given a set of questions to respond to. Instead of going one by one with those, what I try to do is make some, let me put it this way, some sweeping remarks, hoping that there would be some discussion, the Q&A part of it. There are two overarching points that I want to make, and of course the first one is that despite the fact, unlike Pakistan, the national security issue has not featured significantly in the public discourse or policymaking endeavors, except during political crisis. And there is another caveat to it, which Naeem Mohaiemen has already addressed to, the Chittagong Hilltrust situation. And my point here is that why it hasn't been and why it should be, rather, in my judgment. I will come to that. And the second overarching point that I'm saying is that the separation that we usually draw between what is called the traditional security and the non-traditional security and the external security and the domestic security, all these things are increasingly becoming irrelevant. And I guess this is a reality that is dawning on Bangladesh is more in recent days than it used to be. When we talk about national security, mostly in the conventional term, what we know for sure is this national security is mostly about the borders. Borders means when they're talking about border, they're talking about a spatially demarcated area that you can take a look at it and you can protect. And the whole concept of having the Chittagong Hill Tracks has been driven by that understanding that there is a border that we need to protect, and there is, of course, the territorial integrity in questions. Whenever there is a rise of any legitimate demand of any voice to be included in the public discourse in terms of the basic civil rights, then the state's response has always been, oh, there is a challenge to the territorial integrity of Bangladesh. And since 1972, precisely as we speak even today, if we are talking to any policymakers, and irrespective of political parties in power, whether it's the military or the elected civilian regime, and I reserve the right not to say democratic, I always say the elected civilian regime, not necessarily a democratic one, and I haven't seen anyone yet. I mean, if I do, I will be the first one to go ahead and say it's a democratic regime. But so far, since 1972, whether it's a military government or military-backed technocratic regime, as we have said about a regime for 2 years, and then the elected civilian regimes, which have been elected through, yes, fairly election, none of them have gone beyond that notion of national security, that it is must be a territorial integrity issue. And that is what has been the predominant notion of the traditional security. Similarly, in the non-traditional security senses, mostly lately we are talking about all sorts of things. In case of Bangladesh, the most prominent non-traditional security which is coming up is, of course, the climate change and the water issue. And this separation, and that's why what I see that, of course, putting that marker that here the security issue, there is a line that we can draw, yes, there is a border with India and that's where it ends. No, it doesn't, you know. Based on that, let me point to this, that the security issue and Bangladeshi politics, as we know, that very acrimonious. I mean, these two political parties, Bangladesh Nationalist Party and Awami League, which is, you know, alternately came into power, they disagree on many things. But there are a few things that they agree on. They don't say that they agree on, but in action they do. One is the notion of national security. When it comes to Chittagong Hill Tracks, whether they are signing a so-called peace treaty, again, so-called peace treaty, because it makes no difference whatsoever. The presence of military and CST has not gone down since the signing of the CST peace treaty. The assault on the local people has not gone down a little bit. I mean, they didn't get a single inch of land since that treaty. They haven't been included in the no voices have been included. That is an agreement, what I see among the political parties. In the similar fashion, if you look at the defense expenditure of Bangladesh, what you will see that this is exactly an agreement. Between 1988 and 2009, you have seen the consistently the defense expenditure has gone up. And each and every time, if we go back and look at the statements of the finance ministers, irrespective of party, the argument is we want to modernize the defense. Modernization of defense, in the name of quote-unquote modernization of defense, we have seen over the past, and I just put from 1988 through 2009, the defense expenditure hasn't gone up, and consistently it has gone up. And this is important on two counts. First, if we look at this one, the defense expenditure, vis-a-vis health or agriculture. Yes, lately agriculture has gone a little bit up in the recent years, but again, when we're looking at the defense expenditure, these numbers are based on what is allocated at the beginning of the fiscal year. Nobody goes back again, and if you do, each and every year, and at the end of year, there is always an additional budget that is passed and attached to. In Bangladeshi parliament, whether it is effective or not, whatever discussion we have seen in regard to the budget, one thing that has never been discussed, never ever been discussed, not a single parliament member, irrespective of their political party, has ever asked the question in regard to the defense budget. None. You can go through the proceedings page after page, whether it's 7th Parliament, 9th Parliament, 5th Parliament, even the Parliament, which is effective or practically dysfunctional institution in my judgment, nobody ever questioned where the money is going. And nobody talks about it. And the reason that I think the other aspect of the defense budget, not only that whatever allocation is made at the beginning of the year, supplementary allocation are made at the end of the fiscal year when most of the other sectors are actually returning money. In case of Bangladesh, the budgetary allocation never exhausted in none of the sectors. And I'm making that you know, it's not an assumption. It is based on past 6 years' budget that I have looked into. Not a single sector has ever exhausted the money that had been allocated to them. Whereas defense is the only sector where we have seen the money is not only exhausted, they have overspent and they come back to the government with a supplementary allocation in the next year that they are getting the money. So this number, if you add to that, then you'll see this is a country where, yes, defense budget is way behind the health. It has always been, and it remains so, with the argument that we are trying to modernize the army. In Bangladesh, the only sector in the budget where the entire money is generated from the internal resources. Meaning that whatever Bangladeshis are generating, there is a priority then. Nobody is talking about that priority, but it is a de facto priority that defense should get. Bangladesh has a dollar, if it's 60 cents goes into anything there in the defense, the 60 cents is coming from within the internal resources. And that has been the case whether it is 1998, 2008, or 2011. So this prioritization, actually, it is not only about money. It is, though Bangladeshis don't discuss about it, and as I said at the beginning, those caveats that generally speaking, the defense expenditure is not discussed, and the whole question of security. Then why Bangladeshis are spending so much money? Why the Bangladeshi policymakers are making this much money to making sure that the money is spent on the defense? So there is a mindset of this whole notion of security, which is what I would call, you know, basically a security of the border. But as I say, there are caveats. Caveats means, of course, the Chittagong Hill Tracks is an exception. Exception means that shows that there is already one aspect of this discussion of the security issue. What we see on another case, another situation where the whole notion of the security comes forth is a security during the political crisis. Take, for example, in 1981, when Zia-ur-Rahman was assassinated, post-1981, when General Irshad came to power, the new ruler, between 81 May and May 1982, over a period of 1 year, Bangladeshis have been discussing about what is called National Security Council. Similar situation we have seen in 2006, 2007, and 2008. The whole argument is that there has to be a National Security Council to do what? We can avoid these all sorts of political crises if we have a National Security Council. So whether it is the security of the border or at that point, what are they trying to protect? Oh no, this time they're not trying to protect the border. They're trying to protect the institutions of democracy. So precisely, but the centrality of the defense institutions are there. I mean, whether it is modernization of army to protect Bangladesh from India, perhaps because Bangladesh is practically encircled by India. When Bangladesh is spending so much money on modernization of military, I assume that they are trying to protect Bangladeshis from India. You know, I think so. I mean, otherwise, why would they spend that money for? And then they are trying to protect the Bangladeshis from this. Democratic institutions need to be protected, and that is where the whole notion of the security. But as I said, is this a shift? No, this is not a shift. Whether it is between 1981-82, when the military ruler is trying to justify the takeover and institutionalize the role of the military within the political realm, or whether it is 2006, 7, or 8, you know, whatever may be the intention, whatever may be the situation, again, the centrality of these defense institutions are not going to. Why? Because over time, they have built this kind of an institution which actually tries to insert itself into the political process and try to, you know, make sure that there is a legitimate, constitutionally guaranteed for a sort of role that they can play. So it is, apparently it's a shift from the security of border to security of an institution. Essentially, it is not. As I said at the beginning, that these four dimensions, that the traditional security, which is the security of the borders, or, you know, non-traditional, such as climate change, human security, some of which was discussed yesterday, unfortunately I missed those, or for that matter, you know, external and internal security, these things no longer actually can be compartmentalized. And where I see, for example, and this is just an example, I'm not suggesting that this is the only place it is converging. One of the places that is converging is on the issue of water. A simple thing it may sound, or it may appear, that the sharing of the water, common rivers, with India, it is basically now the Bangladeshis are claiming more, not because they want, just because they want to pick up a fight with India, because it is a sheer necessity, given the not only potential, Bangladesh is the front line of climate change. It has become, it is no longer a theoretical proposition. However, the people in Washington or Geneva or London speaks that as if it is going to happen sometimes in future. The refugee, the climate refugees are already moving. I mean, whether, you know, it doesn't have to be something of a dramatic one. And that's why it's not in the television screen every evening or once in a while, because it is happening slowly. And why it is happening? Because, among other things, the scarcity of water. And that is why the sensitivity towards the Tista water sharing deal, which was supposed to be signed, wasn't signed. The deal was not made public. But what we gathered from the media is not an excellent one. It was not a great one for Bangladesh anyway. But not having anything is making things worse. That's why Bangladeshis are insisting that there has to be something, at least 25%. It's not a good idea to have a 25% share. I don't think that's a good idea. But the sensitivity towards this not signing a deal, as we have seen, the popular responses, reactions, you don't have to wait for the political opponents to speak about it. The reaction from the common people, from the civil society, from every single walks of life is an indication that this is a very sensitive issue, and here it is taking a security dimension in the sense, because here you see the convergence of what is traditionally called security of border and what is usually we call non-traditional security threat. These are converging, and it is not converging in the policy making, but it is converging in the public discourse and spilling over to the political rhetoric, which in future might be a very serious matter to deal with, unless it is dealt at this moment promptly in a judicious manner. And in this context, it is not the Bangladeshis we can do anything about it. Whether the Indians are aware of it, willing to accept the fact that they will have to sit around the table and discuss this openly, frankly. I understand West Bengal's demands, Mamata Banerjee's demand, that there should be more water for them and so on and so forth. I understand when the Bihar is demanding that the whole Ganges water treaty need to be renegotiated. I understand that one. But as someone from Bangladesh, as a Bangladeshi, I would claim that we should get more. As much as the Bihar or the West Bengal would do. That's why there is a need for this cooperation somehow. Will that happen? Call it pipe dream. There's no other option. It has to take place. At what point, whether it would be pushed into a situation, whether there's no other option but to decide and come to a conclusion, I hope not so. Any discussion on Bangladesh's security issues cannot simply avoid the question of the militancy. The militancy issue, the increased violence of, and particularly Islamist militancy, which have, spent some considerable time in the past years or decade, following that one, it is a crucial security challenge. And that is, this crucial security challenge also tells us that it is not entirely a domestic thing, because the militant groups have not been a response to the crisis within Bangladesh. It is largely a result of some sort of collaboration with Pakistan-based Lashkar-e-Tayyaba, Harkat-e-Zuhad, Jihad al-Islam, and not to mention the Burmese Rohingya issue. There are a number of issues, and not all of them are within Bangladesh. So they're drawing in inspiration and support. Where are they getting their weapons from? Militancy is not an ideology only. When we are talking about militancy, we are talking about people carrying weapons and having suicide bombing or other things. It is not only unscrupulous, profit-seeking merchants of death who are engaged in this business. They do, but there are other instruments. And there are enough evidence to suggest that Pakistani and Indian intelligence agencies are in some form or other involved in providing these weapons. For their own political reasons, is Bangladesh becoming eventually a political theater where this proxy war would be fought? Bangladesh has becoming a launching pad for having some sort of militant activities in India? Bangladeshi government is trying to protect itself, but how far would they be able to? Time will tell, but so far the indications are not great. But talking about Islamist militancy, about Bangladesh's quote-unquote internal security is not enough, because there is a low-intensity left-wing militancy. In some cases, it has taken the form of extortion, but in some cases, these are ideology-driven. Whatever The reason there are factors within. So when I'm talking about militancy, when I'm saying that the Islamist militancy is inspired by external issues, not necessarily that all things are from outside. It's not finger pointing to other people. There are reasons which is creating this so-called low intensity left-wing militancy within Bangladesh. So a combination of these two, you know, whether in the Western and the Southwest. So what are the conclusions? Can Bangladesh actually handle this situation, what I'm describing as the external and internal and traditional and non-traditional? This combination is making it very difficult for a state. And a state, yes, time to time it takes a posture of a very strong state, but Bangladesh state, I'm not sure the Bangladesh state is weak. Yes, it is. It has been very authoritarian in terms of dealing with the oppositions and all sorts of things, but the internal political instability, fragile democracy, it is not capable yet of addressing domestic problems. How it is going to address these issues? I wish I could end my presentation with a very positive note. Unfortunately, I'm not yet convinced that the things are looking up very good at this point. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ali. Though our conference starts with the title Beyond Security, the security panel has 5 speakers, unlike others which had 3 or 4 speakers. So we still have 2 more speakers, and our next speaker is Saadia Toor. She's an assistant professor of sociology, anthropology, and social work at the College of Staten Island here. Her main research interests are about culture, nationalism, state formation. Her latest book is The State of Islam, Culture, and Cold War Politics.
Thank you, Hassan. Just a small correction. I was assistant professor at the time that the original conference was supposed to be held. I am now associate professor. It's very nice to be here, both in Colombia and in this position of authority, suddenly. I wanted to thank, obviously, Janaki for inviting me and Dina for persuading me to come and stay on the security panel, because initially I was like, I'm not sure I want to talk about security. But I think what I want to talk about will hopefully link up with many of the themes that have come up. I'm actually going to take you back in time to 1947, and not to the partition itself, although that itself, that event itself was a matter of security for all the people who migrated, and for others as well. But specifically to the, between 1947 and 1952, the national language controversy. And before I go there, I want to sort of set it up in terms of why a national language controversy should be discussed on a panel on security. And I hope that when I'm done talking, and I'm going to take the liberty of reading from my book, because I feel like I put enough effort into writing it that I should be able to coast on that for a while. But seriously, I want to sort of begin with the premise that crises of national security, real or manufactured, are actually very productive for states, and particularly nation states, since we're talking about national security, and of course of, for the class interests that they represent. And as I believe Shuja-sahab was saying earlier, internal security issues are extremely interesting and important to look at, both from a sociological point of view and politically as well, if we want to understand what goes on in nation states and how nation state formation occurs. And so sort of that takes us back to the fact that national security is configured along two prongs. There's the issue of external security, and then there is the issue of internal security, right? And I just wanted to read you something from the English language newspaper Dawn, from back from, I believe this was 1952, and Dawn was writing, actually commenting, this was an editorial, on Ecuche, actually on the firing, the police firing on peaceful language demonstrators in Dhaka. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a bit, but I just wanted to sort of read out to you why internal security is so interesting and important for us to talk about. So according to Don, the real threat to the nation lay not from external dangers, which in fact actually helped to strengthen national unity. It was, and I quote, the internal danger which, through whispering, instigation, and insinuation, and mutual belittlement, can break the collective will more than the enemy's big guns and battalions. So that sort of sets up the issue of why a national language crisis or controversy might take on the proportions that it did in Pakistan. So just to sort of set this up, 1947, everyone I think is familiar with the sorts of political and social and cultural crises that that event brought with it. And so there were, of course, for both India and Pakistan, possibly more for Pakistan for various reasons, real issues of crises of the state, ideological, political, economic, et cetera, which if people are interested, we can explore later. But my story sort of starts with a national education conference that was held in November 1947, in which basically, along with a bunch of other things, sort of touched on the issue of what might be the most appropriate medium for national level education, or if indeed there should be one medium language medium for study. And the conference itself sort of gave a very qualified recommendation saying that Urdu might be considered a candidate. And the politics of the conference itself are interesting, and again, we can talk about that later if you want. But following this, this very sort of qualified set of recommendations, the Federal Minister for Education started making a lot of public statements about how Urdu suddenly was to be the national language of Pakistan. This, of course, catalyzed a huge reaction in East Bengal, because Bengalis rightly felt that there had been a national level conversation about this. And secondly, given the fact that they were more than 50% of the population, and that Urdu was in fact the mother tongue of a very small number of even West Pakistanis, that if there was an appropriate candidate for the national language of Pakistan, it should in fact be Bengali. The Pakistani state's response to this very legitimate suggestion was a frankly mystifying display of state violence and force. So I wanted to sort of, that's what I'm going to talk about how it actually justified that kind of a violent response. So this story is part of a larger chapter in the book, in which I sort of tie it to a bunch of other things. But so go back. So it's November 1947. There are all these national crises. This sense of external threat from India. In this climate of national insecurity, all demands for regional or provincial rights, especially those couched in cultural terms such as the language controversy, were framed by the Muslim League establishment as a direct challenge to the very legitimacy of the Pakistani nation state. It was hardly surprising then that Muslim League politicians and the organic intellectuals of the ruling class attacked Bengali demands for equal political and cultural representation in the new nation state as unpatriotic and even seditious. And this is the theme of sedition that really comes to define this five-year period and this controversy. As far as the Muslim League's ruling clique was concerned, East Bengal posed a potent political threat. It was demographically Pakistan's majority province, with over 50% of Pakistan's total population, which meant that within a truly democratic setup, East Bengal would dominate national politics. East Bengal also had a history of political awareness and activism, and had seen a gradual rise in grassroots militancy and political consciousness after the establishment of Pakistan, which threatened the class interests of the ruling elite. Moreover, East Bengal was home to the majority of the new nation state's Hindu population, many of whom were active and vocal members of the official opposition and not content with being subsumed into the category of Dhimmis. The Muslim League thus tried its best to contain East Bengal and deny it its rightful representation in the nation state, both at the symbolic level in the imagined community of the nation and at the level of the state, that is political representation, recruitment into the bureaucracy and the military, and access to economic resources. As the Muslim League progressively lost legitimacy in the aftermath of independence, limiting, neutralizing, containing, and ultimately actively undermining East Bengal's influence in national politics became the major preoccupation of the West Pakistani ruling class. From the perspective of this West Pakistani national, of the West Pakistani national intelligentsia, East Bengal appeared to embody all the tensions of the nationalist project. It had a sizable minority of Hindus. Bengali language and culture was, according to them, irredeemably and inordinately influenced by Hinduism. And by demanding that Bangla be given the status of a second national language, this was actually the demand, is that if, you know, we understand that you might not want it to be the national language, but at least consider it to be the second national language. And by demanding that Bangla be given the status of a second national language, Bengalis had effectively shown their disdain for the idea of a shared Pakistani culture. This narrative dovetailed neatly with the political imperatives of the state, in particular with the ruling Muslim League Party. As a result, East Bengal was increasingly constructed in the popular West Pakistani imagination as a problem province, the place where all subversion against the nation state was located, and therefore the place which had to be constantly policed, both literally and figuratively. Okay. The national language controversy thus stood at the nexus of most, if not all, of the crises and challenges faced by the Muslim League at this time, while also exposing the non-democratic character of its leadership. Having squandered the moral authority it had built up prior to independence as a result of the classes whose interests it now represented, the Muslim League proceeded to respond to all challenges by resorting to repression. It is telling, but hardly unique among post-colonial states, that this repression was effected through quintessentially colonial instruments of power: safety acts, security bills, press and publications ordinances, and declarations of emergency. The use of these instruments and of state repression of legitimate democratic dissent was in turn legitimized through a discourse of sedition in which East Bengal figured prominently. Following the tragic events of February 21st, 1952, in which, as I just mentioned, the East Bengal government fired on, or gave the order to fire on, peaceful language demonstrators, the nationalist press in West Pakistan and the rhetoric of the central government in the Constituent Assembly became rife with references to subversive elements at work in East Bengal. These subversive elements, it was claimed, were none other than the, and I'm quoting here, one community which was foremost in the defiance of the order under Section 144. And Section 144, you must all be familiar with, is again a colonial hangover which prohibits public assembly, right? The community whose members had, and I quote again, instigated the local Muslim youth against the Muslim refugees from Bharat, that is India. This is Dawn, writing in February 23rd, 1952. While Dawn's language is oblique, referring, for example, to, and I quote, number of non-Muslim foreigners, unquote, who had been arrested while distributing inflammatory leaflets, again Dawn's words, it is hard to miss the fact that the absent referent in its discourse are Hindu Bengalis. Even the leftist Pakistan Times quoted the Civil and Military Gazette's editorial, which claimed that, and I quote again, misguided students were exploited by political self-seekers for their own nefarious ends, and noted that, according to reports, among those arrested were many Hindus distributing anti-Urdu literature. This helped lend credence to the claim that there were obviously powerful elements at work in that wing of Pakistan who see in the adoption of Urdu in the end of their hopes and the frustration of their designs. And this is the Pakistan Times, the left-wing newspaper, writing in February 29, 1952. Thus painting the language movement as nothing more nor less than an attempt to destabilize Pakistan. At the same time, the adoption of Urdu as the sole national language of Pakistan was pitched as crucial to the thwarting the efforts of these fifth columnists. Dawn claimed that East Bengal was targeted by such elements, I quote again, because they believed that if they can disrupt that part of Pakistan first, then half their nefarious battle will be won. The implication of this discourse was that East Bengal was the weakest link in the national security chain, and that this had everything to do with the substantial presence of Hindus. Rajkumar Chakravarti, a Hindu member of the Congress from East Bengal, justifiably complained that whenever there is trouble in Pakistan, it is attributed by the people to the enemies of the state, and by insinuations, the Hindus are regarded as these enemies. Another Hindu member from East Bengal echoed these concerns, pointing out that it has become a fashion to put blame and to question the loyalty of Hindus in Pakistan. In fact, the level of paranoia generated around the issue reached incredible heights. sometimes verging on the ridiculous. Wild allegations of men having come across from West Bengal dressed in a different way to incite the demonstrators and spoil the peace of East Bengal were aired in the Constituent Assembly and thereafter in the press. The discourse of alterity was clearly at work in the reference to the supposedly different sartorial style of the alleged West Bengali infiltrators, obviously meant to imply that they were Hindu. This chain of signification, dressed differently equals Hindu equals Indian, also relied on and reinforced the idea that to be a Hindu was not to be Pakistani, or to be not Pakistani. Sri Dhirendranath Datta, another opposition member from East Bengal, complained to the Speaker of the House about the level of mistrust of Bengali Hindus. If we put on lungi, poor Muslim clothes in Eastern Bengal, it is said we disguise ourselves. If we put on dhoti, then it is said that we have come from West Bengal. There is such a sense of mistrust, and this has been engineered under the government of Pakistan. This, by the way, was in a discussion on the finance bill in 1952. East Bengal thus came to be constructed as a troubled province which was home to all manner of seditious elements, from Hindus to communists, with a language issue as proof positive of their nefarious plans. This was the only way in which West Pakistanis could make sense of the language controversy, because surely authentic East Bengali Pakistanis had no reason to challenge the unity in the cultural and linguistic fields, as one letter writer to the Pakistan Times referred to it, which was the prerequisite to the unity and solidarity of our nation. The headline for Dawn's lead story on February 23rd, from which I quote a little bit earlier, 2 days after the Equishay tragedy, declared that all Pakistan will grieve and our enemies will derive comfort and cheer from the tragic happenings at Dhaka. And by the tragic happenings, you can be sure that Dawn was not referring to the police firing. This discourse of East Bengal as in turn a vulnerable and a malignant slash seditious place was extremely useful for the state, since it justified the use of its repressive powers there. The official line of the Muslim League government was that the action taken in East Bengal was tragic, but had been necessary in order to preserve law and order. The nationalist press in West Pakistan concurred by presenting the incident as a result of the conflict between their, the students' convictions on the one hand, and the principle that law and order be maintained on the other. Dawn managed to recast the government's actions almost as a necessary public service. The young demonstrators who had been killed by police fire had, according to Dawn, no doubt sacrificed their young lives for a cause they passionately believed in and acted in their own light as true Pakistanis. However, in the final analysis, they had regrettably violated law and order, obviously under the wicked instigation of enemies of our country, who exploited their youthful emotion to throw East Pakistan into a turmoil. Therefore, however much one might regret the firing due to the incidents, it must be clear, even to the blindest, that it would have been suicidal folly for the government to have allowed these subversive elements to go unchecked. This was all Dawn. Ultimately, despite the generally sympathetic tone in which it talked about the misguided students, Dawn held them and not the state responsible for the tragedy. They should have known that subversive elements had chosen East Pakistan as the base. They should have realized how dangerous it was to play with the emotionally inflammable question of language in such an inherently explosive situation. These are also Dawn's words. In concluding its editorial comments on the Dhaka incident, Dawn absolved the state, therefore, of all responsibility for the violence it had inflicted, supporting its claim that the demands of law and order took precedent over democratic and civil rights. The immediate attention of the provincial and central governments should turn to the existence of this secret network of enemy agents responsible for instigating the language issue, who are actively assisted by their local supporters. The language issue is only one of the weapons in their armory. Their real objective is a much bigger and more ambitious one. Therein lies the real danger to East Pakistan. Before that danger, the tragedy of police firing pales into comparative insignificance. This was Dawn. Okay, I've been told I have 3 minutes, so I'm going to skip ahead a little. All right. Both the corporate interests of the classes represented in the state, as well as their colonial training, mitigated against the idea of accountability to ordinary citizens, and indeed to responding to legitimate political and cultural demands by these citizens. And taught bureaucrats to view with instant hostility even legitimate democratic demands made through legitimate democratic means. Sardar Asadullah Jan, an opposition member from the Northwest Frontier Province, noted that for the bureaucracy, the citizen is not the bearer of public rights. He is only a taxpayer whose only function is that he must obey the orders of the bureaucracy. Under such a regime, the opposition's call for the right to personal and civil liberties did not have much hope of creating an impact. The opposition could just as well have asked what the goal of the government of Pakistan was. The freedom and happiness of the individuals who compose it, asked Asadullah Khan, or that of the state. In the case of East Bengal and the language controversy, the issue was exacerbated by the highly derogatory attitude of non-Bengali members of state institutions towards Bengalis, and by the fact that there were no Bengalis in the higher echelons of the civil service of the military. The Muslim League repeatedly used the pretext of various real and imagined crises to justify suspending civil rights, including the holding of elections, by the simple expedience of declaring an emergency. Under an emergency, power shifted to another colonial hangover, the Governor General, who could dismiss political representatives at will. Mia Iftikharuddin, who was a leftist member of the opposition, took to referring to the Muslim League government as the executive committee, neither representative of nor accountable to the people. Crises are, of course, never in short supply in newly independent decolonizing states, and they can be eminently useful for them when it comes to consolidating power. The language controversy, especially in 1952, was one such useful crisis in that it provided the central government with the justification it needed to increase the extrajudicial powers of the executive, citing emergency conditions, resulting in the passing of several safety ordinances and security bills, sardonically referred to by the opposition as insecurity bills, which themselves had been important tools in the arsenal of the British colonial government. One of the bills tabled at the session of the Constituent Assembly immediately following the events of Ecouche, for example, was a central public safety ordinance, similar in scope to the provincial one which allowed for preventive detention, censorship of the newspapers, and the arbitrary imposition of Section 144, which banned public assembly. Mushtaq Ahmed Gurmani, the interior minister and a prime example of a bureaucrat turned politician, defended the need for such measures. A newly established state necessarily has problems of great magnitude and complexity. The first essential condition for the solution of these problems is the firm establishment of an administrative machinery adequately empowered, capable of ensuring the stability of the state and the maintenance of law and order. Every effort must be made not only to build up a sound administrative structure, but also to make certain that the hands of the executive are strengthened in all spheres. The provisions of the Safety Acts and Security Bill gave an unelected executive the right to compromise the personal and civil liberties of the nation-state citizens through summary trials and denial of habeas corpus. The opposition expressed concern that the act would be used for political purposes, as indeed the Provincial Public Safety Act had been in East Bengal, and that the denial of a person's fundamental rights was a matter of grave concern for a purportedly democratic country. The fact that the wording of the act was vague in terms of what counted as a threat also drew heavy criticism from the opposition in the assembly to no avail. I fail to understand, says Sri Chandra Chattopadhyay, a Hindu opposition member from East Bengal, who is not connected with subversive movement according to this definition. With this vague term subversive action, anything will be subversive. There is no definition of subversive movement, therefore I oppose this. Sri Chattopadhyay's speech made clear the implications of taking a stand for any democratic demand in the face of such legislation. And these are his words. If we say that we are against the two-nation theory, we want all citizens of Pakistan to be one, all Pakistanis, you will say this is against our basic conception of the state and its theory. Therefore, this is a subversive movement and you will be liable to arrest. Who will protect me? I may say, do not make two nations, make one nation, irrespective of caste, creed, and color. Do not divide the people into Pakistani and non-Pakistani, like Muslim and non-Muslim, and you will say subversive movement. Hindu opposition members from East Bengal, such as Chakravarti and Chattopadhyay, were among the most vocal proponents of a pluralist national culture and a federalist state structure, both of which the Muslim League understood as anathema to its bid to stay in power. East Bengal was also the locus of the strongest opposition to attempts by the Muslim League to define Pakistan as an Islamic state, a strategy that it had resorted to in order to hold on to its increasingly elusive moral authority. The fact that some of its most strident critics were Hindu opposition members from East Bengal thus provided the League with a happy coincidence, because it could pitch the language controversy as a Hindu conspiracy to undermine Pakistan, while effectively neutralizing some of the most vocal voices of opposition in the Constituent Assembly by the mere fact of their religious identity and support for Bangla. After Hindus, communists were the fifth columnists of choice in the discourse of the state and its organic intellectuals. In fact, where the loyalty of Hindus could only be obliquely questioned, communists were openly declared enemies of the state. This was in part a testimony to the fact that they were a perpetual thorn in the side of the Pakistani establishment. In East Pakistan, they were important players on the political and cultural front, including the language movement. In West Pakistan, they were stronger on the cultural front than the political, but even then, their support of Bengali demands, among other things, was seen by their liberal nationalist detractors as evidence of their treachery. The debates from the Constituent Assembly show how productive the discourse of subversion was, for it allowed the state to frame both individual liberty and the will of the public as threatening, thereby enabling the construction of what Stuart Hall has called a law and order society. Hence, we have Mushtaq Ahmed Gurmani arguing during a debate on the Central Safety Ordinance that freedom is freedom only when it is consistent with law and with discipline, and that individual freedom and civil liberty are dependent on the national freedom and national security. Individual freedom and civil liberty is only possible if the country is free. If you ensure the security of the country, it is only then that you can enjoy individual freedom. Thus ran the argument, the imperatives of security were a precondition for the guarantee of civil liberties, and under the current state of emergency, conveniently imposed by the Muslim League government, were critical to the integrity of the state. Thank you.
Thank you, Saadia, for that very important historical context. Our last panelist is Mooed Yusuf, who is currently South Asia advisor at USIP, United States Institute of Peace. He's been a fellow at Harvard University in Boston and writes regularly on policy issues, Pakistan-India relations, Pakistan's foreign policy, U.S. foreign policy. And today, Mooed is a friend, so I can take liberty that now we have hardly about 30 minutes left, so it will also be a test of Mooed, how can he summarize his presentation into about 15 minutes or so.
I'll be happy to go straight to questions and answers if you want. Thank you very much. Thanks to the organizers. Thanks for having me here. I do realize we are late, and I also realize that I stand, I keep you from a presentation by Mr. Ehtezaz Hassan, who is a much more engaging speaker and probably has much more substance to contribute. So I'll try my best. I'm a trained political scientist, and I feel I'm going against the grain of what I've heard in the past day and a half for at least three reasons. One, I took the questions and basically I'm going to focus on this security, economy, development debate in the Pakistani context. I'm not going to look at the entire sort of slew of questions that were thrown at us. Second, I don't know whether I'm left, right, or center. So whether I'm confused or schizophrenic, I don't know. But I tend to change positions based on issues. So within my presentation, you probably find that I waver, but that's what it is. And third, I think there's a lot of discussion in the past day and a half at the individual level, at the organizational level, about society. I'm going to pitch this at the system level. For those of you who are trained in political science or international relations, I'm going to talk about the structure of South Asia and the relationship between two South Asian states. Janaki mentioned that she'd kept India out of this intentionally. I'm sorry, I'm going to go back to that and talk about the Pakistan-India relationship to explain what I think is a security development disconnect within Pakistan and the implications of how Pakistan has looked at this particular relationship. So let me just begin a map of South Asia, but the point I want to make with this slide is that you're really talking of India and the rest of the countries in the region, whether one likes it or not. There's an overbearing presence of a particular country. And it's unique in some ways because there is geographical centrality attached to the overbearing economic presence, trade presence, you know, 3/4 of GNP, population, etc. So it truly does become, not in the tendencies, but in terms of the structure, geographical structure, a hegemonic presence with the other countries around it. And I build my model, which I'm working on, so this is a work in progress, but I want to throw this out and base my argument on this. How do you explain peace and conflict in South Asia? And the argument here is that South Asia is essentially linked with a hub and spoke formulation, with India at the hub and the rest of the countries as the spokes. Each one of them in the traditional SAARC before Afghanistan came in had geographical borders or maritime boundaries or a link with India at the center. As the spokes and this particular hub find a suitable equilibrium for coexistence, which by definition is more sort of preferable or more inclined to the preferences of the hub, you have peace. So you can take different countries. There are varying degrees of dependence that these countries have on this hub, which is India. Nepal, Bhutan, certainly much more than countries like Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, or Pakistan. And India's had troubled relationships one way or the other with all its neighbors at different points in time in different degrees. As India and a particular spoke has figured out where an equilibrium lies, you found peace to ensue between those two parties. So you can take the example of Nepal, go back in history and look. Maldives, one intervention by India. Sri Lanka, a great example, IPKF, and then sort of moving back from that. But once you go through that conflictual phase and find what your equilibrium point is, there's a mutually beneficial relationship. And India's, to my mind, foreign policy has been found to be fairly restrained towards that particular spoke. If you look at this system, again, I think there is an equilibrium point found to varying degrees with all other spokes except one, which is Pakistan. And this is a spoke which became obsessed by not allowing what many Pakistanis say, the Nepalization of Pakistan. This particular spoke became obsessed with holding out and not falling under the sphere of influence of this hub, on terms which were preferable to the particular hub, which is India, of course. And in this case, the hub reacted in a tit-for-tat fashion because it also did not like this arrangement. When all the other spokes had to fall within the sphere of influence, this particular spoke should have as well. And it didn't for 63 years. And that explains a perpetual state of conflict between this particular relationship, which you don't find in the others in South Asia. And I could explain the Afghanistan link and the competition between Pakistan and India in Afghanistan through this model as well, but I think that's irrelevant. The interesting part here is that this particular spoke is not strong enough to create a parallel hub. You know, international relations, classic realism, balance of power is one way you get peace and submission is the other way. So the spoke is not strong enough to create a balance of power on its own. And thus it goes and bandwagons with an extra regional power, which is China, and does so fairly successfully to hold out against the hub over its history. But the hub, which is India, is not strong enough to force this spoke into submission either. And thus you've got a very sort of uneasy tension which escalates to conflict at certain points because one of these powers was a revisionist power for the longest period, which is Pakistan over Kashmir. But you've got a situation where both cannot do what they really want to do to the other. And thus you've got this uneasy tension, but a state of conflict rather than coexistence, which I think has been found in the other cases, again, to varying degrees. And thus, if you characterize the Pakistan-India relationship, you don't have to look at this too carefully. Basically, what I'm saying is there are multiple nodes of conflict which have played out, both domestic and foreign. Ideologically, there are internal subversions that both sides have done to the other, the intelligence agencies, etc. There are external drivers, sometimes helpful, sometimes not. And then, of course, bilateral disputes is the major issue. But what you end up with is fairly minimal economic interaction, lack of people-to-people contact, deep-seated mutual distrust, and really a zero-sum mentality when it comes to the states. Now remember, I'm not talking about the individual citizen or the society here. I'm talking of the construct of the state and how they're portraying this particular system and interacting with it. Let me then move to basing my argument on this model. What is the implication? What are the implications for the state of Pakistan and the society of Pakistan of this particular relationship? And I could do exactly the same for India, but since the focus is on Pakistan, I'll do that. Essentially, the argument is that Pakistan's national narrative has been securitized, singularly because of this obsession with India over the years. The threat of India lies at the heart of it. If you go back to 47 and start looking, the military had a head start in terms of its institutional capacity compared to the political elite at the time. And the military bureaucratic alliance that there's a lot of literature on developed very early on, which dwarfed sort of the political aspects of the state within the first decade. And you've seen that trend continue. And then, of course, you had this 10 years of General Ayub Khan where there was an aura of stability, progress, etc. And Asim talked about the contradictions. Well, those contradictions were not the national narrative at the time. And so you had this sense where the philosophical commitment to democracy, to my mind, was lacking from the very beginning. And the military was somewhat very oddly revered for having produced the goods. And the military then becomes the ultimate arbiter of national interest and remains so to this day in Pakistan. What does this securitization of the national narrative do? I'll just very quickly touch upon five things and then talk about if there's a way forward. But the first one, of course, is guns versus butter. And this is where the human security aspect comes in. A lot has been talked about. I'm not going to sort of go through these slides in detail, but I've just put out numbers. You know, Asim talked about this debt and defense kind of spending, leaving nothing else for the state. Where the money is going, the priority has always been skewed towards development in some ways. This is a telling slide. Ali Riaza put up something, but, you know, fairly similar, perhaps worse in Pakistan's case. But the point to be made here is that resources have been skewed and the priorities towards defense. The other side of the coin is that even with the resources that have been employed towards development, the development has been fairly exclusionary. So you've got fairly impressive macroeconomic growth, per capita growth over Pakistan's history, not translating into good social indicators. In fact, dismal social indicators. So on the one hand, you've got this skewed resource distribution. On the other hand, whatever has been spent on development and the people have not produced the goods for the average citizen. Again, some slides that we don't need to go in, but there are economists sitting here, but income inequality rises just as your macroeconomic growth is also fairly impressive, a structural issue. So there's a guns versus butter argument, which I think plays out very critically in Pakistan. Again, something just to say, if I were to keep putting education, health, sanitation, etc., under nourishment indicators here, the story would be much clearer. Second, I think this particular model that I projected has led to foregone regional integration. Shuja Nawaz talked about this as well, but again, India-Pakistan trade, yes, 2 billion, but he mentioned a figure of 100 billion. There are other gravity models that one can put, which I think are somewhat more realistic, but the number is much larger than what they're trading at this point. There are also figures of informal trade, which quite frankly are picked out of a hat. There are numbers of 5 billion, 10 billion, 30 billion. I've never seen any methodology behind it. The point to be made is that Pakistan and India have a much greater potential to trade and invest than they have to this point. I always love to put three figures up, and this is a great indication of Pakistan, the state of India-Pakistan relationship. The visas, the number of cricket matches, and the number of fishermen released in a year. Gives you a very good indication of where the relationship is headed. The only thing to note here is 2003, 8,000 visas, up to 95,000, and suddenly down to 50,000 immediately after Mumbai, and further down now. So, you know, again, a very good indication of how these states operate in a very Machiavellian kind of calculus. Intra-regional trade, South Asia is the least integrated in the world by far, and one hopes that does change. Again, the column on the right, the percentage share of intra-regional trade in total trade of South Asia, minuscule. The two countries that we're talking about, mostly India, Pakistan, 2.82 and 6.18% of their total trade. Again, a slide which shows how little they trade within the region. All this making the same point. One other interesting fact, Pakistan and India, apart from SAARC, are not or have until very recently not been part of any other extra-regional, sub-regional arrangement. A lot of people tell me, well, we actually cooperate in the WTO. That's correct. That is true. But if you look at the pattern of sub-regional, extra-regional trade agreements, India and Pakistan have ardently tried not to be in the same one as the other. It's BIMSTEC. You look at anyone, pick up. It's changing now because there are now a couple where they're coming in. But to give you a sense of their sort of calculus, when India says bring Afghanistan into SAARC, Pakistan says, okay, give China the observer status. Go back to the model and think about it. The offsetting with China is so important in this case for Pakistan that it keeps on playing out every single time. Third, I think there's been a democratic blunder in some ways in a flawed governance model where the civil-military disconnect or the anomaly in Pakistan, again, I'm not making a causal argument, but certainly there's a strong correlation with this obsession with the South Asian structure. And these are different sort of literature, sort of I'm quoting different people who've talked about this, and I'm not going to get into the detail. There are different explanations put out by different people. The bottom line is that the military remains in the driver's seat when it comes to the civil-military disconnect in Pakistan. Why that happened, one can go and talk about it. But this particular sort of, you can call it an overbearing presence of the military, starting right from the very beginning, there's a bi-directional correlation, I think, with how the state imagined India and the threat from it. And once the military gained importance and prominence because of that, there's a feedback loop which reinforces this idea of Pakistan looking at the South Asian structure as it does. Let me also add something here, which is the other side of the coin and not a very popular argument, but this is my dissertation work, so I better agree to that. 3 minutes. Last speaker, huh? And that is that there's been a governance failure equally on the civilian and the military side. In Pakistan, the entire civil-military discourse is civilian versus military. And my argument is that actually the failure is not because one is better or worse than the other. The failure is because both have ruled Pakistan in an identical fashion. Centralized, exclusionary, patronage-based, etc., etc. I don't have time to get into that, but there's a civil-military disconnect combined with an identical failure of governance on the civilian and military side. And both have ruled Pakistan almost equally in terms of number of years. The external drivers have played a role. The US, the securitization of aid, working closely with Pakistani military rulers, the Saudi Arabian Islamization of aid post 1980, the madrasas and a particular brand of Islam. And China, of course, with their security relationship with Pakistan, has reinforced and allowed that offset of the hub to continue for longer than it would have. And then, of course, the final implication, the curse of militancy. Again, I don't want to make the argument that just because of this India issue is Pakistan's militancy blowing up today. That's not true. But certainly there is a link to the policies, the foreign policies that were pursued in the past 30 years, whether by the US or Pakistan or whatever, but it has played out, and what you see on the Pakistani streets today, it's really the chickens have come home to roost, and if Mr. Nawaz is correct in saying that the military can't take them on, there's a serious problem. What do you have then? You essentially have a security-heavy focus, an exclusionary sort of economic growth, civil-military imbalance, a flawed governance model which isn't working, and thus Pakistan remains in this cycle of civil and military rule. And then an internal security blowback which comes out in the form of militancy. Hassan, if you allow me, I want to spend two or three more minutes on the final part, which is that is there a correction possible? Sure. I don't think I've gone over time, but give me about three. There are two basic options here to correct. One is you alter the system that I talked about, which is the South Asian structure that I presented before. How do you alter that? There are two ways. Either you take away the root cause due to which Pakistan has been behaving the way it has, which really means solve the problems with India. And there, I think, in some ways, the onus lies on India to a large extent. And I'm not too hopeful because I don't see that kind of paradigm shift even within India. If I were really looking at it in a liberal sort of formulation in international relations, as an Indian, I would essentially say move all forces from the Pakistani border and open up trade with Pakistan. I'm the larger market, shame them into this. But there are particular bureaucratic, etc., and states don't do that. This is not something that they do. The second option is to overwhelm the root cause. There's a lot of talk now that this particular spoke called Pakistan is no longer strong enough to stand up to India, even if it offsets using China. So there may well be a time when the Pakistani state basically says, we simply can't do this anymore. And there again, I would argue that things are moving. Traditional positions are changing in Pakistan. I agree with Mr. Nawaz when he says that, but much too slowly, because there are vested interests, there are bureaucracies, there are institutional disconnects. And so even this is going to be long time in coming. So I don't think either India will move or Pakistan will move too quickly to actually mend fences as one would hope. Finally, the other option is you change the position of the institution that has been holding on to this policy, which is the military, internally within Pakistan. And there, quite frankly, I think that's really the hope. And I completely agree with Asim that if you have to do that, if you have to change the civil-military disconnect within Pakistan, the only hope is to allow the political process to continue. It's not going to happen overnight. I hope it does, but it won't. And so the real hope there is to change the civil-military disconnect from within. I completely disagree with arguments which says use the US, use external parties, change the aid structure, maybe that changes it. It won't. Has to be an internal effort and has to be a continuation of the political process which ousts the current characters who, again, I think you're absolutely right, elected civilians and not democratic, and brings in real democratic leaders. Thank you.
That independence for both nations that have been discussed on this panel has failed to cater to the needs of the people. And so I wonder, my question is, when will we see a Pakistani spring or a Bangladeshi spring, if you accept the contested notion, right? The Arab spring means that winter's coming. So, some people don't like that notion. But when will we see a people's revolution? What will it look like and where will it come from?
We have two more questions. We'll hear about the Pakistani Spring next.
This is partially because I actually believe it, and partially to provoke both Mooed and Shuja Saab to think differently about this. I'm not the last thing Mooed said, about ousting the current characters. I just don't agree with that. It's as if to say there's something about Pakistani politicians which makes them just infinitely more unbearable than politicians anywhere. Why is it? Why did we maintain an attitude that, our politicians, are somehow responsible for the military's dominance? Is anywhere else in the world does corruption and malgovernance and mismanagement, does that mean that coups are justified? I just don't get that. That seems to me to be, you leave space when you say, there's the democratic blunder, or the politicians are also responsible. There cannot be any justification for the military to step outside its constitutional mandate.
Pakistan has an army of 500,000, and then I think you said it has a reserve also that brings it up to 800,000. And then you said that it's not able to take on the militants within Pakistan. And I just wanted to ask about that. I don't know what would be required. And then I wanted to ask Professor Riaz, What is the role of the RAW and the ISI within Bangladesh or around concerning Bangladesh?
Great. Panel will take these questions.
Do you want to take one more?
Okay.
If everyone's okay with it, we can go until about 5 to 4, but then I'd have to ask you all to come right back. So if that's all right with everybody, we can just sort of go straight from here into the plenary session. Yeah? Okay. All right.
I really appreciated the way the whole panel, you know, reminded us of the historical basis also of these security issues, and then we came up to the different examples, say from the Chittagong Hill Tracks for Bangladesh. It reminded me of my own work on Kashmir. I mean, it seems every nation really must have these blind spots to create the sense of security for itself. What the question I wanted to ask really was how, as Professor Riaz showed us, some of the more, well, other matters that we wouldn't normally consider under security, like water, are also being subsumed now under the security discourse. And I'm wondering why that cannot be turned around and say something like water be used to get us out of the old boring and shackling paradigms, you know, of discussions that move nowhere. Water, for me, is where all the emotions are as well. And so I'd like the panelists to say something, whichever ones which want to discuss it or address it, on the issue of water. I think it would be quite nice to hear a bit more about that.
Great. Shuja, you would like to take first shot?
Sure. I've actually just written a column on the issue of the Pakistan Spring for Newsweek, which would be appearing in this, I hope, the end of this week, unless they get cold feet. This is Newsweek Pakistan, and you never know what the publishers decide and what pressures they come under. But it basically started off from the Occupy Wall Street movement, because I think that is really the issue. If there is going to be a change, it has to be a change from the street. And I don't know if Asim misunderstood what I was saying, but I don't think the change can come with the army being in the driver's seat again. And neither should we rely on that as a source of change in Pakistan. Yes, we should hold the politicians responsible. I don't alter my view, but equally we should hold the military responsible, because I think Mooed also said this, that both the military and the civilians have done a tremendous disservice in terms of governance to the people of Pakistan over the years. So if there is a change, it has to come from the middle class that Asim was identifying, and it has to come from the cities and from the burgeoning populations of Pakistan cities, perhaps, and then maybe alliances with the rural middle class. But it will come from there if it's going to come, and the demographics certainly point in that direction. If we look at the demographic indicators from the Middle East, then we have the same kind of population cohorts that can bring change. The direct question to me was, given the relative large size of the Pakistan army, why can't it take on the militants? The reason is, the army is a conventional army. It has changed and tried to change in the last 2 or 3 years to fighting what they call low-intensity conflict. But you cannot win an insurgency by killing people. Neither can you win it by force or with the barrel of a gun. And this is really not something that the military is designed for. Moreover, with the military still being over 60% Punjabi, the potential for tremendous disruption within the military of using a predominantly Punjabi army in central and southern Punjab against their own people, which, as I mentioned earlier, my own research and a paper that Chris Fair and I published shows is the new recruiting ground for the military itself, would create tremendous problems, much more than the morale and other issues that they faced in Fatah and in Swat and Malakand and Dir. Finally, on water, if I may, and this is simply to indicate why I agree that this is a key and one of those very doable issues between India and Pakistan. It is very emotive, but the discussion in the public sphere in both India and Pakistan is extremely poor, and it is based on very strategic leaks by interested parties using the media in order to affect decisions one way or the other. And the military is equally ill-informed in Pakistan about it, because I read one report that the ISI was reported to have raided the offices of one group or persons who had been involved in the Kishan Ganga arbitration hearing, because one newspaper had reported that people hadn't done their work right, and that they had sold out Pakistan in the discussions with India. So there is a need for a much more informed discussion of the fact that both India and Pakistan share these water resources. The situation is going to become worse, not better. Both India and Pakistan have very serious water management issues at home, which they need to address domestically, and not just for the rivers that they share. And both India and Pakistan are, in fact, the lower riparian as far as China is concerned. So there needs to be a much wider debate and discussion on this. At a personal level, my own center is now organizing a track two between India and Pakistan on water, headed by Jaswant Singh and Sartaj Aziz. And we hope we can broaden the public discourse on it. I don't know if we can solve it. Thank you.
Thank you. Mooed, you would like to respond?
Thank you. The question on the spring, I think Mr. Hassan will probably talk about this more, but to my mind, Pakistan has had many springs. The problem is after that, the summer's very, very hot. I would characterize wrongly, perhaps, and you may disagree when you speak. If you look at the Pakistani lawyers' movement, that's a variation of a spring. I mean, it's a different kind. You know, in Pakistan, you're not going to have the kind of spring the Arab world is having, because the structures are very different. I mean, what 30 years of a particular government that has to be thrown out is not something that Pakistan, you know, needs at this. Yes, there will be other reasons why you have spring. Lawyers' movement is one of them. I think if the argument is the coalescing of this kind of momentum, Pakistan has had many, many of those, and quite successful ones as well, and some which have failed. I think the tenor is different. The problem has been what comes out at the other end doesn't satisfy many. So that's I think that's another question. Asim, one, I think you misunderstood what I said. Second, I personally think that the conflation of the democratic process with the individuals who are part of that process is quite dangerous. I think there's absolutely nothing wrong with criticizing politicians, just as there's nothing wrong with criticizing the military. What you shouldn't be after is the democratic process. And I think these are two very, very different things. In fact, my view is that if the people who present themselves as defending democracy actually behave undemocratically for too long, you end up undermining the institution of the democracy. And that's what's happened in Pakistan. The common person on the street gives up hope in the system at some point rather than the individual. So I think I'll stick to that. Second, I think when you say I leave the window open, I do leave the window open. But I look at it as a political scientist, and I can tell you that no status quo power, no status quo beneficiary institution changes just because somebody feels like they should change. If you've got to change the civil-military imbalance, either you have to force them out, which you can't, or you've actually got to outperform them as the civilians. And the example I can give you is Turkey. I've just done a paper comparing Pakistan and Turkey. And apart from the other factors, the number one factor was the anti-establishment party took power and performed for a period of 3 to 4 years. And then nobody looked at the military again. So, you know, I think I'll stick to that. Water is not my subject. The only thing I'll say, quite frankly, is that at this point, the debate I know of Pakistan, I don't know about India, is being driven by the establishment kind of view, which is saying that the entire problem is really an Indian problem, where the fact is that much of the Pakistani water problem is a water management problem within Pakistan. So that narrative, if it's more informed, maybe things start moving differently.
Thank you, Mooed.
Okay, I will make 3 points. First of all, going back to the Bangladeshi spring, 2 points here. Number one, with due respect and support in some ways to the Arab Spring, we have to be a little bit cautious what would be the end product. We haven't seen the end product yet. And as we look very closely at the Egyptian development, some of us may retract our opinions at some point, I guess. Having said that, Bangladesh had its spring in 1990. In December 1990, the popular uprising changed the political discourse and particularly the political landscape of shifting from military rule to or semi-military rule to civilian elected civilian governments between 1991 and 2006. So the spring was there, but what happens after that and at what point we see that spring turn into a hot summer is when the system strikes back. And that is what happened in case of Bangladesh. And there I agree with Mooed that it is not about the individuals. It is about the process and what I'm witnessing. And again, many of my friends may not agree with you, with me on this, that the Bangladeshi democratic process is being eroded by the same elected civilian regimes that were the beneficiary of the 1990 spring. That worries me no less than anything else of having a military regime. I'm not justifying, I'm not exonerating any military regime, but my point is, are they eroding the system itself to that point that it would collapse into something else? Quickly, two other points, role of ISA and RAW. I can go into the details, but if I can take a commercial break here, I have discussed it at length in my book called Islamist Militancy in Bangladesh, it came out in 2002. The commercial is over. The ISI role is very clear as the presence of Lashkar-e-Tayyeba and its use of those instruments to destabilize or at least pinching India from Bangladesh. And the most obvious example would be the seizure of huge arms deal in 2004, which was destined to the Northeast India for the Ulfa and others, which it seems to, it is pretty clear documented that ISI was involved. The question is, what is the role of RAW? I mean, at some point, the Indian intelligence agencies have actually provided support to some of the quote-unquote Burmese militant groups which were operated from within Bangladesh, which then, when it comes to weapon itself becomes currency. And I have seen it very up close. In case of Bangladesh, in the Chittagong hill tracks, the weapons that were provided to Burmese rebels, which later used within Bangladesh, not for any political or ideological affiliation, simply because of the proximity and convenience and opportunity cost. That's the simple matter of it. So that's what the Indians didn't intend to, but to quote one Indian intelligence official, we provided weapons which were used against us in Assam. The weapon was bought by Ra in Thailand, shipped from Phuket, went to Cox's Bazar, distributed there, then it was shifted from Burmese to the Bangladeshi militants, who then sold it to the Northeast Indian rebel groups, which was then used in Assam. They captured it and found out that this is the weapon the RAW provided money for. Thank you.
We have time for a few questions.
Yep.
Just a quick question. Great panel, wonderful listening to all of you. Both Naeem and Ali Riaz talked about the possibilities of how Bangladesh can become a good state. But from the Pakistani contingent, except Saadia told us a little historically what had gone wrong. Can Nawaz and Mooed tell us what would make Pakistan a good state?
I'm not defining it. I'm just taking the statement from a very old book of Campbell Smith of 1957, where he talks about the issue, what would make Pakistan a good state?
I'm not sure about the exact relevance, but I was thinking about Naeem, your place as an artist and a filmmaker. I was just curious to know about what you might think of, you know, cultural producers within the landscape of, you know, Pakistan or even Bangladesh, you know, artists and filmmakers and writers, when you're talking about, you know, a revolution or a movement of the people. And, you know, even within, say, something like Occupy Wall Street, I think there's a huge contingent of, you know, art and the cultural sort of presence in terms of how they can influence and if that might have any relevance in even ultimately influencing going a more non-traditional way in addressing issues of, you know, policy and security. Sorry.
Thank you. In answer to your question on what would make... Sorry.
I was just going to take one last question.
So my question is about Bangladesh in particular, and I realize this may not have a quantifiable answer. So Naeem, you spoke about the project of Bangladesh nationalism, and other panelists have spoken about that too, how it's become this kind of rabid thing that takes us back into the past instead of moving constructively towards securing the state. And I think one symptom of that, I think, is this continual celebration of what it means to be Bengali in public and political discourse. So my question is, I guess, that if there are no real, you know, kind of threats, both internal and external to the project of Bangladesh nationalism, I mean, why is it that there seems to be this threat, this perceived threat, in the imaginary? And is that a hangover of the 1971 war? And how do we start to feel safe again?
I request for brief answers from all three of you so that we can then take a short break and then go and listen to Abbas.
This is in response to the question of what would make Pakistan a quote-unquote good state. I think Pakistan's already on the way to becoming a good state if we follow some of the trends. After all, we made a transition from being a state that operated under a troika of the president, the army chief, and the prime minister through a very imbalanced pogo stick, which was Musharraf. So long as he could maintain his balance, he was fine, but he was all things in one and inherently an imbalanced situation, to a rather rickety, uneven, four-legged stool where you have the president and the prime minister on the one side. I think you have a very powerful emerging role of the judiciary on the other. You have the military still playing a role because of its control of various foreign and domestic policy issues that I talked about. And then you have a very noisy and emerging role for civil society evident in the media. So that's one. Secondly, in the process of devolution, regardless of how messy and ill-planned it was in terms of its implementation, the fact that Pakistan is going back to its original constitutional roots as a federation, and the provinces, if they're ready, willing, and able to take on their responsibilities, will then be able to create a center that'll work for them rather than the other way around. And third, the fact that India and Pakistan are talking to each other. I think once that external threat and hostility ceases to be a guiding force of all actions inside Pakistan, then there is a strong possibility that the polity of Pakistan will take a natural development, like most other good polities.
That means India is also becoming a good state.
Any, Saadia, any comments on this?
Did you want to respond?
I was just going to respond to the question.
Okay, please.
Look, I mean, one, you have to understand when we talk about this, we're always in a moment of time. Pakistan is a state under the microscope. So a lot of the problems which many other states, every single state has, they become blown up. And a lot of the problems then, I think policy-wise, the priorities get wrong. I'm not saying they're not problems. All of these are problems. But if you look at indicators, things are moving in the right direction. They're moving much too slowly. A lot of things, the terrorism part, the security part is going wrong, but the ones that Mr. Nawaz has mentioned, rural economy, for instance, I was in Pakistan for the past month, went around. A lot of the things are actually, the vector is in the right direction. The pace is much too slow, there's no question about that. Whether that'll make Pakistan a good state or not, I don't know. But I think the single silver bullet, if you will, is normalization with India. I mean, I'll go back to my presentation, but if you can change that dynamic, you open up the economy, you open up this sort of space to criticize this right-wing rhetoric on how they see the model that I presented, I think that's the silver bullet. Of course, not to say that you don't have to fix a number of things internally, but we have to take this in perspective. When a state has so many multiple organ failures, as a state which is already weak, you can only pick some and start doing them. There'll always be others. You know, I always tell people in Washington and donors who say, well, you know, there's no accountability, they're not doing this right or that right, and I always remind them, if they were doing all of that right, you didn't need to go there in the first place. So, you know, let's take that in perspective, but there are a lot of problems which have to be solved.
So I'll be quick. You know, it's interesting to hear questions that ask, that use words like rabid and past, and also even questions about Arab Spring, et cetera, because it feels like people are hearing what they want to hear, but not all the other things that are in there. So for example, in my presentation, I very specifically use the words commercially opportunistic and profit potential for Bengali racism 3 times. And it was very specifically desire to take things out of an emotional and just cultural project to also the economic rationale behind things. But yet, I've made these presentations before, and people always ask these questions that seem to harken back to like some larger, soft, how will we become better people? How will we become better state kind of thing? So just to give a couple of quick examples, in Chittagong Hill Tracks, it's absolutely about resources. It's about land, and it's about control of the land. That's what the fundamental battle is all about. In which both Bengali settlers are involved and the military are involved. And the solution also has to involve resources. If we go back to Saadia's presentation, and when she talked in great detail about the 1952 language riots, you know, the riots and all of that about it wasn't just about speaking Bengali so you can, you know, practice Tagore songs or things like that. It was about jobs. If the state language of Pakistan was going to be Urdu, that means if you didn't speak Urdu, you'd be automatically disenfranchised from jobs, especially government jobs. And so it always comes back to resources. So for example, I don't agree 100% with Ali Riaz's characterization of only 1990 as our only spring. But for example, if we look at 1990, 91, and also if we look at 2008, both times when a military government stepped down, the military government also stepped down when it became too costly. Right? It became too costly for the military to continue defending Ershad in 91, so they jettisoned him in some ways. And in 2008, the UN peacekeeping operations was a huge factor because Bangladesh is the largest supplier of troops, and that was threatened being cut off. That was also a factor. So I think for me, it's important also to look at the economic rationale behind things, the leverage, because that also gives space as an activist to figure out where is the space to change and get different results, because I don't believe that we'll get the results just by changing people's mindsets, because that's not the only thing. Just quickly about the question about the visual arts versus, let's say, the academic setting. Since I'm in both, I would say that the thing I do note, and Sarah Hussein was somebody yesterday who said, you know, the work that you or others do in the visual arts is not so useful. You should be writing academic essays as the one you did in EPW. And I appreciate Sarah's very particular direction, but I do feel that within the academic context, there's almost a hurry to get to the answer. In various conferences I've been to, the three phrases I hear most often start with what, how, and when. So people are almost in a rush to get to solutions. And I find that in the visual arts, often, especially these days within conceptual and political art spaces, there seems to be more generative spaces for more open conversations that are not in such a rush to get to the solution. So I hope there'll be more mixing between the academic world and the visual arts.
Last 30 seconds and then we'll conclude by Ali.
Okay, 30 seconds. Just to highlight the point of the water, I wanted to come back. Why securitize the water issue? It is being securitized not because it was designed or someone planned it. Basically, lack of transparency of the administration of the government in the context of Bangladesh increasingly gave rise to the suspicion that something is behind that. And that itself has generated a concern about the security. And now that every day, it is being experienced by common people every day, they try to find out an answer. And in the context of Bangladesh, you may know, if you cannot find an answer, there must be a conspiracy.
Thank you very much. Just a one-liner conclusion. I think with all the different, very rich, insightful presentations that we have heard, I think to me it is clear that security issues remain at the center of debates about democracy, discussions about trade, understanding of social movements, reaction from the people, insurgencies. So we need to look at security issues from increasingly from a non-traditional perspective as well. Thank you very much for your time, and thank you very much to all the panelists for their great presentation.